So that took us really up to the late 60s, at which time one could say with some certainty what was not wrong with thalassemia. We still didn't know what was wrong. You could either there was going to be, for some reason, a decreased amount of normal message, or there was going to be some subtle molecular abnormality that none of us understood. And then we, of course, moved into the Nuffield, and into the the Institute of Medical Genetics in Liverpool, which you came about 69, I guess. Yeah, that's right. And there were two interesting, I think those early years when you were in the lab, that's between about 60 and 65, were really exciting years, actually, because we were able to diversify our interests a bit, obviously. Like everybody else in the field, we were interested in fetal haemoglobin and looking for natural models, like the ones that you looked at in pregnancy and so on. And we were still looking for natural models which might lead us into the thalassemia molecular field. And something came along, I think it was about 1971, it just was a letter from Jamaica, from a chap called Paul Milner, who said he'd got this family with alpha thalassemia, with haemoglobin H disease. And he'd had a funny electrophoresis because there was some tiny amounts of a funny haemoglobin, which he'd not seen before. Now, I was just looking at the correspondence the other day, and I wrote back and said, well, you know, could this be a very badly synthesized alpha chain? Let's have a look. And that was, again, by this time, Clegg and I, we really did work extremely well together, but we knew how to split the work. Because Clegg hated blood or anything red, made him sick. So I used to do all the kind of initial preparations and then give the purified white powder to Clegg. And making purified amounts of this tiny amount of material is about 1% of the total haemoglobin. But we used to do a lot on amberlite exchange columns those days. If you fix the molarity of the phosphate buffers adequately, you could separate a lot of different hemoglobins. And we knew that there was conditions where things like A2 and that would stick tight and you could wash off everything else. So prepared an enormous amberlite column, a kind of pornographic thing, and shoved grams of this hemoglobin from one of these patients on top of this column and just went washing it day after day till it was clean of everything that would come off it, and then just poured some concentrated salt across the top, and this band came down. And so I was able to present Clegg, I think, in the end with about 3 or 4 milligrams of semi-pure hemoglobin, which we later called haemoglobin constant spring, because the family came from Constant Spring, which was a little suburb of Jamaica, of Kingston. Anyway, Clegg was very surprised when he fingerprinted this to see that, you know, a few extra peptides which weren't there normally. And when he strung them together, it was clear that this was an extended alpha chain of about 30 residues. And if you looked at the structure, what clearly had happened was that the normal termination codon, which is CAA normally, terminated CAT or something or other, and then put glutamine in instead of terminate. Yeah, and this suggested that there was message beyond the normal terminating codon, which was not normally used until you reach another in-phase stop codon. And actually, you could even, from the amino acid structure, anticipate what the nucleotide sequence would be. So we published this stuff in Nature, and our friends in Cambridge, Fred Sanger's lab, are all working on the structure of human message, Tim Proudfoot and Tito Baralle. They thought, you know, bloody amateurs, that this is a load of old rubbish. It was really great, actually. But then they got alpha globin message sequences exactly what predicted from constant spring. So that was one molecular defect, a chain termination mutant with the production of a tiny amount of mutant haemoglobin.